A criminal defense attorney weighs in on the merits of Trump's criminal charges. Lynn Almadin Thornhill reports.
What the prosecution is going to try to show during the trial is that Trump not only knew about the payments, but that he intended for the payments to essentially help him win the election, to conceal it from the voting public, right? And so what their case is really going to come down to is what evidence do they have to prove that. We know
Filipino-American Matthew Halandoni is a criminal attorney and a former Ohio State prosecutor. Halandoni says not only do the prosecutors face a big hurdle in connecting the dots to prove their case to the jury, but also the credibility of their witnesses.
Michael Cohen, his former attorney, the attorney who made the quote-unquote hush payments, is going to be very prominently featured in this case, and his credibility is going to be very important. Does the jury believe him? Do they think that he is lying because Trump, you know, threw him under the bus, or, you know, he's now himself a convicted felon? Can you trust him?
As a former state prosecutor, Halandoni knows how crucial it is to bring a solid case to trial.
Not only do you have to believe in your case, but you have to look at it objectively and say that I have the evidence that I can win this case, and not only win this case, but make sure that it stands up on appeal.
Even if he is convicted, many legal experts doubt that 77-year-old Trump will be sentenced to jail time.
Typically, for defendants in the position that Mr. Trump would be in if he's convicted, he's a first-time convicted offender. This is a financial crime, not a crime of violence necessarily. It's the lowest level felony. Typically, if you look at that, that's going to generally result in probation rather than jail time.
But Halandoni notes that there's no guarantee the judge will order one way or the other.
Judges are going to consider a number of other factors, like punishing a particular offender, whether someone accepts responsibility during the sentencing phase, protecting the public, and deterrence, right? So they want to show the public that essentially this type of behavior won't be tolerated. And the way that a judge might want to do that is by sentencing the defendant to jail.
Trump is required to attend the trial each day, which is expected to last through May. Lynn Almadin Thornhill, ABS-CBN News, Manhattan, New York.
Now in the United States, former U.S. President Donald Trump back in a Manhattan courtroom for the second day of his hush money trial. The jury taking shape with seven people selected. Before leaving the court, Trump again slammed the judge and blamed the Biden administration for his legal troubles.
He's a conflicted judge. As you know, we're in appeal. More conflicted than this one, so we'll see how that all works out. We're having a hard time with the New York State system. It's under watch by the whole world, and it's not looking very good. So we think we have a very conflicted, highly conflicted judge who shouldn't be on the case, and he's rushing this trial, and he's doing as much as he can for the Democrats. This is a Biden-inspired witch hunt, and it should end very quickly.
The trial will resume on Thursday. Trump faces 34 felony counts of falsifying business records to cover up a hush money payment to porn star Stormy Daniels shortly before the 2016 elections. Trump has not pleaded guilty and denies an encounter ever took place. As Trump sits in the courtroom, U.S. President Joe Biden kicked off a multi-city tour of the battleground state of Pennsylvania. It included a stop in his hometown of Scranton, where he pointed out a stark difference between him and Trump.
You know, people like Donald Trump learned very different lessons. He learned the best way to get rich is inherited. Not a bad way. He learned that paying taxes was something people who work for a living did, not him. You learn that telling people you're fired was something to laugh about. I guess that's how you look at the world when you're in Park Avenue, Mar-a-Lago. But if you grew up in a place like Scranton, nobody handed you anything. You paid your taxes. You made sure being told you're fired wasn't entertainment. It was a nightmare that people worried about.
Iran expected to release four Filipino crewmen soon on a container ship it seized from the Strait of Hormuz. This story from Victoria Tulad.
2 days after the Iranian Navy seized the container ship MSC Aris, its four Filipino crew were able to talk with their families in the Philippines. They gave good news, according to the Department of Migrant Workers, or DMW.
As of midnight last night, they managed, the four families of the seafarers managed to directly communicate via video call with their loved ones on board. They also have been told by Iranians who came on board that they will soon be released, not just exactly know where and or not just know exactly when.
The DMW says the seafarers are being treated well.
We know that the seafarers, the four seafarers, are safe and sound. They're eating well. They've taken to their normal duties on board the ship. The DFA is also doing coordinative work in terms of the discussions with the Iranian government.
MSC Aris was seized on April 13 near the Strait of Hormuz, which is between Iran and the United Arab Emirates. The ship is currently anchored at the port of Iran. According to the Department of Foreign Affairs, or DFA, it is a Portuguese vessel which has ties with Israel. Israel and Iran are in conflict. Despite the situation, DFA remains optimistic since Iran released the 18 Filipino crew of MV San Nicolas, an oil tanker that it also seized in January 2024.
Tingin namin makatapalaya rin ng ating mga kababayan na hindi tatagal.
The Philippine government promised financial assistance for the families of the four seafarers. Their manning agency also assured support.
The licensed manning agency assured us of adequate payment, fulfillment of the contract insofar as salaries and compensation is concerned to the families.
Because of this latest incident, the Department of Migrant Workers will recommend the declaration of the Strait of Hormuz as a high-risk area. If this happens, a Filipino seafarer may refuse to be assigned in this area and instead be designated elsewhere. But if he chooses to still sail in a high-risk area, the pay, however, must be doubled. The Gulf of Aden and parts of the Red Sea have also been recently declared as high-risk areas. In November 2023, Yemen's Houthi rebels seized the cargo ship Galaxy Leader in the Red Sea, taking 17 Filipinos hostage. Efforts continue to bring them home. In March 2024, the bulk carrier MV True Confidence was struck by a Houthi missile in the Gulf of Aden. Two Filipino seafarers died with their remains yet to be recovered. 13 others were able to come back to the Philippines. Victoria Tulad, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Madrigal Singers kick off their three-month-long tour in Canada with a successful concert in Vancouver. Take a look.
The Christchurch Cathedral in Vancouver was packed on April 13 as the Philippine Madrigal Singers took to the stage to perform. The last time that the acclaimed choral group was in Canada was 13 years ago. The two-time European Grand Prix choral singing winners captivated the audience with their repertoire of Renaissance and classical music, international folk songs, and of course, Filipino songs. They also debuted on stage the piece Awit 123 or Psalm 123 in Tagalog, done by Filipino composer Jimwell Dave Dagta.
It's amazing. Nakakatuwa na bumisita sila sa Canada and we are the first one to experience this amazing concert. I'm really, really happy to be here.
The range of their repertoire, they're tuning, they're so tight. Their capacity to sing so many different genres.
The Madrigal Choir Master Mark Anthony Carpio says they did not expect a warm welcome from the appreciative audience.
We were surprised, actually. There was a lot of cheers going on, and we were grateful for that welcome, the reception, the standing ovation.
Founded in 1963, the Philippine Madrigal Singers is celebrating this 2024, its 60th year Diamond Jubilee with their three-month Canadian tour. The Madrigal Singers got their name from the Italian word madrigal, which referred to the kind of secular vocal music popular during the Renaissance. Carpio notes, though, that this genre is dying fast, but with new singers waiting in the wings, they are able to keep the music alive.
We do have our pool of trainees who sing with us in our rehearsals and sometimes in some performances. But the recruitment is continuous.
Filipino Youth Choir Himig ng Kabataan and the Bandurya Number and Saxophone Performance opened the Madrigal Concert. The UP Alumni Association in BC and other organizers are very happy with the success of the tour kickoff in Vancouver.
We didn't expect it to be really successful, but I'm very happy that it really is a massive one, actually. And this is, I think, attributed to everyone ramping up to be able to make this happen.
Bevilacqua is grateful to the families that hosted the 18 members of the MADS and to the community leaders like Cliff Belgica of the UFC ABC who gave them valuable support. Meanwhile, Andrada says they opted to stage the concert in a more intimate venue like the Christ Church Cathedral so the audience can really enjoy the music.
Gusto lang natin yung sense of intimacy. It's really like bringing them back home. Just that feeling of being back home.
The Philippine Madrigal Singers Canadian Tour will see them performing in the cities of Toronto, Montreal, as well as in Ottawa and in Winnipeg, among others. Proceeds from the tour will be used to build the Madrigal Choral Institute in Antipolo back in the Philippines. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.
Award-winning filmmaker Ramona Diaz chronicles the Filipino people's fight for democracy during the 2022 polls in her documentary, And So It Begins. Watch this.
In discussing And So It Begins, the documentary she stars in, 2021 Nobel Peace Prize awardee Maria Ressa laughingly recalls that she did not quite agree with one storytelling decision that award-winning filmmaker Ramona Diaz made for the film.
We've seen you brave, and you do that here too, but seeing your vulnerability too, did you hesitate at all in putting that on screen?
Yes, a lot. I got mad at Ramona. I was like, stop showing me angry. I spent my entire career learning to squash my anger, right? And then she only shows me when I'm angry in this film.
That's not true. Not only when you're angry. That's not true.
Oh, and then getting surprised by the Nobel. She zooms in only on these moments. Like, all my calmness is gone in this film.
Our problem is that that emotion is vulnerability. That is vulnerability for a journalist. That will be attacked. The best part is it's not about Rappler or me.
Ressa has a good reason to be concerned. As someone who advocates for truth in journalism, for many years, she endured being the target of hate by vicious online trolls focused on people who report on former Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte. Among other things, And So It Begins chronicles the effects of his presidency. But in the end, Ressa says that what the film provides in terms of information and insight is more important, especially in light of appalling efforts to dismantle press freedom and influence elections in countries like the Philippines.
What measures can be done to correct it?
I've spent most of the last 2 years working on policy, really outside the Philippines. You know, I no longer have an editorial role in Rappler. In order to solve our problems in the Philippines, we have to go outside the Philippines. We have to make sure that these tech companies are not exploiting us.
And So It Begins continues the story started by Diaz in 2020's Peabody-winning documentary, A Thousand Cuts. The film highlights the hope, heartbreak, bravery, and challenges faced by Filipinos during the 2022 presidential elections between Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Lenny Robredo.
What was it like capturing that on film?
It was overwhelming to capture it, and we captured a lot. So even the putting it together was also overwhelming. VP Leni always says she didn't know, they didn't know whether it would be a lonely campaign. They thought it would be a lonely campaign, and then people just started showing up in numbers. And you can see this is the end to something or just the beginning. And that's why we also called it And So It Begins. We wanted to lean in on the hope.
Did the Marcoses have any reaction to the making of this film?
Not yet. but we were, I wasn't allowed to film any of the rallies, right? I'd welcome their reaction.
And So It Begins premiered at Sundance earlier this year and will be one of the top billed offerings at the 40th VC Film Fest. The Los Angeles-based film festival highlights stories from diverse filmmakers and communities. Apart from Filipinos resisting oppression and fighting for what they believe would be for the betterment of the Philippines, Ressa and former Philippine Vice President Leni Robredo are front and center in the movie. The feature-length documentary was originally conceived as an episode for the award-winning PBS documentary series Frontline, which also released 1,000 cuts. And So It Begins screens at the VC Film Fest in Los Angeles on May 2 as part of its Democracy series, which shows urgent and substantial stories from different nations. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.